What do terms like medicalisation and medical dominance refer to? These are consistent themes in the sociology of health and medicine, and sociologists are often critical of the medical profession in a variety of ways. The sociological critique of medical dominance can be traced to Eliot Frightson's two 1970s books, Profession of Medicine and Professional Dominance. Frightson analysed the ways in which a key feature of all professions, but especially medicine, was the capacity to control their work, which gave doctors enormous power in relation to health and illness. The power of medical dominance extends beyond the work of doctors themselves to encompass their conditions and remuneration, allied health occupations such as nurses, their patients, and the very definition of what constitutes a medical issue. Organisations like the American Medical Association, in Britain the British Medical Association, and in Australia the Australian Medical Association played a key role through controlling the number of medical graduates and medical knowledge more broadly. Frightson's account was developed further in the 1980s with the publication of Medical Dominance by Evan Willis in Australia, Paul Starr's The Social Transformation of American Medicine in the US, and Gerald Laskin's Occupational Monopoly and Modern Medicine in the UK. The subsequent debate included scepticism about how powerful doctors really are, and certainly there have been a variety of challenges to the dominance of the medical profession. These include neoliberalism and economic rationalism, which undermined all professional power, including that of doctors, and withdrew state support for the medical profession, a growth in consumerism and associated litigiousness, the change from a cottage industry to a mass market as medicine became industrialised, the rise of complementary and alternative medicine, and the changing roles of other healthcare professionals. It's useful then to frame the issue less in terms of the dominance of the medical profession and more in terms of a broader social process of medicalisation in which doctors are only one set of players. Peter Conrad and Ivan Illich were among the leading American critics of what they called medicalisation and the medical model. Conrad defined medicalisation as a process by which non-medical problems become defined and treated as medical problems, usually in terms of illness and disorders. Medicalization is the process then of redefining normal human bodily experiences in terms of medical categories. In other words, converting ordinary everyday parts of life, such as giving birth, growing old, being dissatisfied with one's appearance, into a medical experience. That is, physical experiences that historically were seen as simply a normal part of growing up, just troublesome aspects of life, are defined through the intervention of the medical profession as problematic, becoming medical problems. There are two senses of medicalization. The first one, which is Peter Conrad's approach, refers to it as medical imperialism. That is, medicalization is the overreach of a legitimate professional approach to dealing with disease. It's taking a framework that works very well in some situations and moving it out into areas way beyond illness and disease. This is what's meant by the medicalization of society. A second way of approaching medicalization is to see it as an ideology or a hegemonic or dominant discourse. Medicalization, it's argued, is a dominant discourse with the medical profession going well beyond their role as healers of illness and disease to becoming the arbiters of the drawing of boundaries between normal and deviant. It's important at this point to pull into view the role of the large multinational pharmaceutical corporations, which in many respects have come to overshadow the medical profession itself. For example, Roy Moynihan's argument is that the relationship between the medical profession and the larger multinational pharmaceutical corporations, with the willing collusion of some patient groups, has underpinned the ways in which medicalization has become a ubiquitous feature of contemporary social life. Moynihan calls it selling sickness and disease mongering, with the pharmaceutical corporations being the main drivers of this process. In selling sickness, the boundaries of treatable illnesses are extended to create markets for new pharmaceutical products, a process driven by the pursuit of profit. There are crucial alliances between the pharmaceutical corporations, the medical profession, and some patient groups, using the media to generate an inflated picture of various conditions as widespread and severe. There are a number of ways in which the pharmaceutical corporations foster these alliances around a perception of various issues to do with the functions of the body and the mind as specifically medical concerns. First, the denigration of alternative approaches in favour of pharmaceutical products. An example here would be the use of antidepressant drugs rather than lifestyle changes. Second, making false or exaggerated claims across the spectrum of both physical and mental disorders, sometimes to the point of actually falsifying research results. Third, working to ensure doctors favour a narrow bioorganic approach as opposed to an approach framed in terms of public health and the social correlates of health and illness. For example, should alcoholism, drug addiction or gambling be regarded as an illness or a character flaw, the critique of seeing these features of human behaviour in purely medical terms includes the point that this loses sight of individual moral responsibility. Another critique is that this interpretation is driven by the pursuit of profit by the pharmaceutical corporations, seeking ways of selling new products to supposedly cure these illnesses when they're in fact generated by particular social conditions which remain unaddressed, treating the symptom rather than the cause. In relation to the conversion of ordinary life concerns into medical problems, Moynihan gives the example of baldness, arguing that the medical profession have reframed this experience as a medical issue, for which of course an expensive treatment is available. He also points to the framing of relatively mild symptoms as indicators of very serious disease, for which there's also a more or less expensive cure provided by the medical profession and the pharmaceutical companies. His particular example is irritable bowel syndrome, or IBS, arguing that IBS used to be simply managed rather than making any attempt to cure it. However, a PR company was hired to reframe IBS as a condition for which there was a treatment produced and sold by a pharmaceutical corporation. The brief for the PR campaign was that IBS must be established in the doctor's minds as a significant, discrete disease state. Yet another arena for medicalisation is the rebranding of personal or social problems as serious medical issues. Shyness, for example, was taken by the big pharmaceutical companies and developed into an illness, social phobia, for which a medical treatment requiring various drugs comes to be provided. Risks also become reconceptualised as actual diseases, with Moynihan's example being osteoporosis. Measures of bone density were used as a predictor of the risk of fractures among middle-aged and elderly people, but Moynihan argues that the relationship between the two is actually quite weak. The corollary of profit-driven medical imperialism is also the failure to address illness and disease when it's confined to a population which can't sustain profitability for the pharmaceutical corporations. When there are health problems in parts of the world where there are insufficient profits to be made because the population and the society is poor, the pharmaceutical corporations simply don't engage in the required research and don't develop treatments. So the rates of illness and mortality remain at levels that would not be acceptable in the developed countries. The most recent example here is the resurgence of antibiotic-resistant tuberculosis in many parts of Asia and Africa. The core concerns in the medicalisation debate include the economic dimensions of how human problems are understood and dealt with, as well as the role played by the interests of the medical profession and the drug corporations. Although it's true that the medical profession is not as dominant in society as it was in the 1950s and the 1960s, the tendency towards the medicalisation of social issues and concerns remains a core characteristic of contemporary society. And the question of power in relation to health, illness and medicine continues to be a major concern in the sociology of health. In summary, the sociological critique of modern medicine began with the analysis of medical dominance, referring to the power of the medical profession in relation to their conditions of work, allied health occupations and their patients. Second, since the 1970s, the power of the medical profession has been gradually eroded with the spread of neoliberalism, consumerism and the rise of mass markets in medical products. Third, the concept of medicalisation emerged to capture the ways in which non-medical problems become defined and treated as medical problems, usually in terms of illness and disorders. Fourth, the large pharmaceutical corporations are now recognised as central to the medicalisation of social issues and concerns, engaging in selling sickness and redefining issues as medical ones in their pursuit of profit from selling drugs.